Welcome, Sally. Thank you for being with us today. We are so grateful for your sharing your story about how you knew Omraam in person and how you were led to his teachings.
My name is Sally Huss. It was Sally Moore long ago. And I was raised as a tennis player, as a champion. And so I did a lot of work as a child, perfecting that skill and playing in various tournaments and events all over the world. And it was a great opportunity for me. And but I was at the same time, I was in school and eventually graduated from SC in fine art. So art was my other talent, you could say. And although I never expected to use that, but I played tennis before money. So there was no possibility of a career in the sense of that. But and then from when I quit tennis, I moved on and did, I worked in television for a particular man who had his own show. And then I worked for Sam Goldwyn Jr. in film, on a couple of films. And that was a very interesting experience. And eventually I worked for Paul Simon in music publishing and ran his music publishing company. Then through the years, I became, a kind of anorexic person in those days. And it was the thing to do was to be as thin as you could or as tan as you could. And so I pretty much destroyed my health. And through a friend who sent me to a dance therapist, and I worked with her and in movement. And she said, because I could not sit on the floor because it was just too painful. So she said, you need to go to this doctor. And so I went to the famous Dr. Johnny Boni, and he was in West LA. He was an acupuncturist and a homeopath. And he worked out of his home. His wife, Therese Farino Boni, were two extraordinary people, and they opened my eyes to a different kind of life, a life with God in it. Although they weren't talking God, 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 like a lot of people, they were talking life. And they had been with a master in Italy and studied under a master named Totti, an initiate, a very extraordinary person. And so they had this background, but they seemed to attract all the really interesting spiritual people that were in the West LA area or who came through there. And they also made contact and were friends with another master who was in the Malibu Hills. And he was a hidden master. He was not a teacher, although you were in his presence, you were certainly being taught. But he was one of the poles. Do you understand the poles? He was one of the four poles on the earth at any one time. So he's a very powerful and extraordinary being. And had a little private time with him, and he, in a sense, said, do you will to be good? And I said, yes. And so that was kind of an initiation. I will to be good. And from then on, it kind of focused my life, you know, rather than having no boundaries, I could focus. And anyway, it was wonderful to be with him and to learn and to be around the Bonies because of the extraordinary people that came through, all the top astrologers, the great Sufi came through, and there were always interesting gatherings. But eventually the Bonies went to, they would visit Italy off and on, and they were on their way there, and they stopped in Paris, and they went to a famous bookstore there, and Johnny went upstairs, he collected books, he went upstairs, and Therese stayed downstairs. And she came upon this little book, brightly colored little book from the Izor collection. And she ran upstairs. She read one paragraph, ran upstairs, and she said, Johnny, Johnny, because she knew this was a great master. And she showed him, and he had in his hand the very same book as so it would be. And the book that she had picked up was out of place in the bookstore. So anyway, there began their interest in that teaching, in the teaching. and their acceptance of him as being the great master that he is and was, you know. And they proceeded to have gatherings at some point, and then they brought the books, the Aïvanhov Omraam books into California through someone who would take care of those and distribute them to the people that they needed. And I think through the heart, your group became acquainted with the teaching at that point.
And so this is Master Omraam you're speaking about.
Yes, yes. And so the books were brought in, and eventually they visited the Bonfin, and then they also brought the master to California. And one of the interesting things was that he said that the teaching to spread to in the United States, it had to start in California. And they were, Therese Boney was an extremely magnetic woman, and she attracted, you know, you just couldn't deny that she was this very superior being. And she brought people together, and they learned, and she read the books to them, and this and that. And so eventually, and that grew, and but the thing was that they eventually had to go back to Italy. And when that happened, kind of all of her followers kind of just, you know, kind of spread out, and they didn't have a person to lead them and have these sessions. But anyway, during that time that they brought him to California, there was a big event in Santa Monica at the auditorium there, and she encouraged me. I was here and there because I was in and out of doing artwork at that time and doing galleries. We had 26 of these galleries across the country, and I was filling them as fast as I could. And I did come down, and she encouraged me to come and be in that group, and I could sense the power and the effect he had on the people that were there. And
so this was Omraam coming to California.
Yeah.
And what year was that?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I can't remember years. Anyway, that had so to be.
You were in the audience in where he was in person. How awesome!
Yeah, it was awesome. And I just noticed that my third eye just kept pulsing, just carrying on like crazy. And then I had a session with Johnny Boney at his office, you know, a doctor's appointment. And he was telling me that one of the women who was his patient had told him, he said, why does Omraam keep repeating himself, you know, going like this? And Johnny laughed, because Johnny was totally clairvoyant, and he could see what was going on in the room, is that the master was holding the people there with his dialogue so that the beings on the other side could work on the people. So he had to hold them there till that work was done. So anyway, we all benefited greatly, even if we might not have known it. But I was in another couple of sessions where he spoke in the Boney's home, and they had the wonderful woman who sang so beautifully and was in charge of the singing at the Bonfin. And anyway, she had moved to be with Therese in California, and she had taken this group that Therese had created and taught them the songs, all of the chants, and taught them in Bulgarian, and they sang for him during that session. And he was so moved that he had to get up and leave the room. He was so touched that they had gone to this effort to learn these songs in his language. So that was a beautiful moment. Another time that I was in his presence, I was living far in the San Diego area, and I had a long drive, and traffic was bad and this and that. And I came in late into this home, and in the room where everyone was sitting, and another gal was late too. And we walked in, And the look that he gave us was, melting, because you just did not do that to someone of this caliber, of this, you know, it was just, you know, he didn't have to say a thing, but it was the look. And that was it. I knew the next time I had the opportunity that I would be there the night before, you know. So it was always teaching. So it was a great pleasure to and an honor to have been in his presence. So that was my opportunity, being acquainted with the teaching and understanding the books and reading the books. And so I had a personal life that went on with raising a child and, you know, a business that I was doing. So I had that going on. But at one point in a dream, at a certain time, I don't know if it was quite a dream, but anyway, I said, Master, what can I do for you? You've done so much for everyone. What can I do for you? And he said, write your story. And I thought, oh, how odd. I never thought I would ever write my own story because it had so many ups and downs and mishaps. And so now I'm in the process of actually writing that book. And it's speaking of this, because all of that teaching and that being around these people, these kinds of people, had influenced my writing of children's books. And I had gone to a seminar of Jack Canfield, and through a meditation there, the golden angel opens a box and she's going to reveal your life work. And she opened the box and just books upon books fell out of this box, just books. And so I said, okay, that's what I'm supposed to do now. The galleries are closed because of 9/11 and all that's done with. Now I can focus on doing the books that I've always wanted to do. So anyway, we now have over 100 children's books in the collection. Some maybe 85 or something, and then another 30 in multicultural version or Spanish or whatever. So now that's what I do, is try, and I, because of the self-publishing, I could do that. And that's how I created this large collection.
And these children's books are basically based on the Omraam teachings, would you say?
No, I wouldn't say based on. I would say many issues. Yes, I picked up many of the things that were important. A book that, a little book here, on the little tea party book, just a simple one, very, very simple little book about a tea party. And the teacher in the mermaid classroom is really explaining to the little mermaids how you pass things from one to the other. And you must never offer anything, you know, a sand bucket or a cup of tea or anything. You must never offer anything to another that is empty. No container must be empty. So that was a beautiful thought, I felt, was a thing. So kindness is a big theme in all the books. And then I remember reading in one of the books, of the Omraam books, that he said that there's one thing, there's only one way in which we are all equal, only one way in which we are all equal, and that is having the dignity of being a son or daughter of God. And so I took that thing, because he said, this is the one thing you should teach a child, is that they are a son or daughter of God, that they are equal in that sense. And so I did this, I took that theme, which is kind of awkward to offer a child. And I did a really, really sweet, sweet book. It's called Kids Get It. And it talked about all the things, how kids could see that they were not equal in so many, many ways. They couldn't understand why the teacher was telling them how wonderful they were because they were all equal. And then she explained why. And so I do take many of the things, but I, you know, and of course, attitude being a huge factor in everything in life. And so I did a wonderful book, Positive Pete. And Pete, I'm perfect, said Pete as he looked in the mirror. He cleaned his glasses to make sure they were clear. Yep, I'm as perfect as I can be. Nothing can upset me. No, not me. So he goes on with great mishaps that go on during the day, he can always see the positive side of it. So anyway, so there are many things. I did a book. I'm not sure that it was extremely popular, but it was about, I call them the sunshiners. And this, and about how this substitute teacher takes his class on this big adventure, and they go to a place, and there are all these little sunshiners. These are little beings that sit on the top of mountains every morning and watch the sunrise and collect the gifts that come in the rays of the sun. And then they go back, and then every day they go outside themselves. So I take a few things like that, but a lot of things are just general thoughts on kindness and anyway.
These sound like books that maybe adults could benefit by.
if the adults get them, if they get the message in them, that's great. It's always a subtle message, so you can't come out and say, be grateful, But you present the situation to see what this way or that way. So that's what I've done.
Basically. Thank you, Sally. It sounds like such a great benefit to all mankind, these children's books and your work. And I love the fact that you ask the master, what can I do for you? What great, because then he answers. He has something to say to you.
Right. I didn't think to do that, but I did. And that's what he told me to do. And that was the hardest project that I've ever done. And I've done it, and I'll go over it one more time and then present it, but either publish it myself or find somebody who's has an interest in doing it. But because of just a regular person who tried hard and always tried to do the best, and how that brings to you the information and the people and the help that you need. So that's the kind of thing.
It looks like our time is about at an end, and I was just wondering if there's anything particular you'd like to say.
Yes, I was given an award, a thing at a big thing at Occidental College where I'd gone to school, and they asked to speak, and I said, and I thought, well, what can I tell the people that are out there? And the first master that Johnny and Therese Boni had worked with was Tati, an initiate in Italy. And Tati had taken all these people, he could combine all the scientists in Rome, and they studied a box of soil. They wanted to see what the energies in soil were. And so what they found was that the energies in soil were chaotic. And until you planted a seed, once you planted a seed, all the energies in that soil lined up to make that plant come to fruition. And that's what I told the people. That's what my father had done. He planted the seed of a champion. So everything I have done was to be the best I could be.
How interesting, because Omraam also has teachings about seeds and how very important that is. So, well, I'm glad everything lined up with the seed your father planted. That's you. So thank you, Sally, so much. Yes. Thank you for being
my
with
pleasure.
Us. I enjoyed your story, and I know our heart friends will also.
Good. Thank you so much.